When you think about fiber, I want you to think about a cleaning crew entering your body. So you've got insoluble and soluble, as you can see here, they work together to help your body through its natural process of cleaning. Our body does a good job, but we can help it. So that's what I want you to think about when you think about fiber. And it does such incredible things for us. It helps regulate our hormones, reducing excess circulating estrogen. It promotes a healthy gut. It balances our blood sugars. It supports our immunity. And it can also help us with weight management. So the goal that we're looking for is 30 to 35 grams per day. And one thing that you want to think about also is that the number is really, really important, because there has been research showing that women who ingest less than that target of 30 to 35 grams of fiber don't have as much breast cancer protection as women who reach that target of 30 to 35 grams, which is what the research is telling me to tell you collectively. Now, we have that number, and it's a tall order. 30 to 35 grams of fiber from produce is a lot of produce. Think about more than half of your bathtub just packed with vegetables and fruits. It's really important to have a strategy. So I'm going to help you with that. But besides the number, you want to think about fiber diversification. What do I mean by that? You want to diversify with insoluble fiber, soluble fibers. And now within the soluble fibers, we have these special prebiotic fibers. And within that, we have beta glucans that are really important for our immune system. I'll cover all that with you guys tonight, but it's really important to not only focus on the number, but about the diversification of fiber. Think of it like an investment portfolio. Diversification is essential. So I'm going to talk about five things that fiber can do for you. And I'm going to start off with weight management. So how does fiber help us with weight management? Well, number one, it helps keep us full longer. It increases satiety, which is great. The other thing is, when you're eating wholesome grains and fibrous foods, it requires a lot more work for your body to break it down. So for example, look at this slice of bread here. This bread right here is 100% flourless. There's no flour. It's just sprouted grains and lentil and different grains that are basically, I tell people to think of it as like they're glued together. So your body, when you ingest that, your body has to work through the barriers of those grains to break it down. I want you to think of that as like food exercise, like a workout, compared to this 100% whole wheat, 21 grain, no matter how many grain bread that has flour, that your body's going to go right through and break it down rather quickly. So the way you want to think of this is as if you're taking the elevator or the stairs to get to the 10th floor. One requires a workout. They both get you there. So, another thing I want to share with you guys is a little shopping tip when it comes to bread. There are many things to look at when you're shopping for bread, but I want you to try doing the squeeze test. So make sure when you're at the store, the manager is not looking, but give it a little squeeze. If it resists squishing, that's a good sign. You want that, because like this right here. And because a whole whole grain, flourless bread will resist squishing. And there are some other things that you want to look at as well when you're looking at the label. Like, for example, this bread right here might have a lot of sugar added to it. There are a lot of things to look at, but hopefully this is a helpful tip. Now, the next thing is fiber's ability to help reduce estrogen levels. So how does it do that? So when we do eat enough fiber, more estrogen is excreted in the stool and less gets reabsorbed back into our blood system. So what you could see here, this is, you could see fiber in action. You see the scrubby brush, which is insoluble fiber. And then you've got the sponge here, which is the soluble fiber. And you've got all kinds of things like excess hormones, like cholesterol, estrogen is what I'm showing you here, potential carcinogens. It's not all just about estrogen. And it basically is going, more is going to get excreted when you're having enough fiber. So you really want to think about those target numbers again. Now, when we don't get enough fiber, as I mentioned, estrogen basically hangs around and it gets reabsorbed back into the blood system. So, and so do other things like cholesterol and other compounds, potentially harmful compounds. And there's been some great research on this. Here's one example, a typical, like a plant-based diet that's high in fiber and low in fat versus a low fiber diet and a high fat diet. And what they did here is basically measure the stool content of estrogen and also measured it in the blood. And it was significantly higher with women who ingested a low fiber, high fat diet. So very important there as well. Next, how does fiber promote a healthy gut microbiome? A healthy gut microbiome is so important for us. And what I want you to think about when you think about your gut microbiome is that how you treat it, just like a garden, what if you're watering it, if you're nurturing it, that's going to determine how things are going to grow and how they're going to thrive. So a healthy gut balances our hormones. It also helps activate phytoestrogens. Those plant-based estrogens are going to be more active to protect us as well. So how do we do that? Well, one of the things we can do is eat a prebiotic-rich fiber diet. So when you're eating these fibers, which you can see here below, some examples, like, for example, asparagus, it has these prebiotic fibers that have direct access to our large intestines, which is where our microbiome lives. So what it does is it feeds the good bacteria. You see you're watering the garden here. And what that does in turn is it creates something called short chain fatty acids, which are these metabolic byproducts, which in turn helps support our immunity. It helps us with weight management and also reduces body inflammation. And this is just food. This is great. And when we have a low fiber diet, we're basically starving our gut microbiome, and it encourages the bad bacteria to take over, which causes something called dysbiosis. So dysbiosis is an abnormal bacterial balance in our gut, and our goal is to prevent that, because when we have dysbiosis, we produce more of an enzyme called beta-glucuronidase, which signals and sends estrogen back into the blood system, which is something we don't want. Now, when we have a high fiber, a fiber-fed healthy microbiome, we don't produce as much of the beta-glucuronidase and more estrogen gets shuttled out of the body through the stool. So that's great. And another thing that a healthy gut microbiome does is it activates plant estrogens, so which come from foods like beans, legumes, flax seeds, nuts, various fruits, yams, carrots, apples, oats. It really helps activate them, and it's very interesting. So they can do a better job protecting us on a cellular level. So that's also kind of great. Next up is that fiber helps us modulate our blood sugars, which is also extremely important when it comes to breast health. So what our goal is, we want to control our blood sugars in order to produce less of insulin growth factor 1, IGF-1, which is basically a pro-inflammatory growth hormone that could potentially stimulate tumor cell growth. So the great thing with fiber, especially soluble fiber, is that it acts as an extra set of brakes, helping control and manage our blood sugars, which is important for the prevention of so many diseases, and including offering us great protection when it comes to breast cancer. Next up is fiber's ability to strengthen our immune system. I can tell you 5 years ago, I probably wouldn't have imagined that I would be talking about this. This is really, really great stuff. So, you know, those special prebiotic fibers that I was talking about, the beta glucans, which are found in oats and other foods and the asparagus, they have a dual function in that they, number one, act as those prebiotic fibers that feed our friendly gut bacteria, as you can see right here. And then the other thing they do is they enhance our immune system because they're interacting with our immune cells in the GI tract to stimulate our immune defense. And that is just fascinating to me. So that's important as well. So enough with the sciencey stuff. What are you guys going to do tomorrow? You know, what can you do? What action can you take tomorrow to gradually increase your fiber goal to reach that magic number? So one of the concepts that I introduce through the Beller Method in the Transformation Masterclass is to get at least 10 grams of fiber before noon. And that is really, really important. And when I worked in the research setting, reviewing different dietary intakes from the participants, I realized that if you're not starting on that high note, it is very difficult to get to your target of 30 to 35 grams, even if you eat a salad every day for lunch and a lot of veggies for dinner. It just doesn't happen. So it's really important to have a simple strategy, 10 grams before noon. And one of the best ways to do that, choose a fiber booster. Like you could do basil seeds and chia seeds, and a prebiotic fiber powder is great, and flax is great. There are so many options on the market. Start with one, just one, include it, and then start rotating them, because remember, diversification is very important. Another tip that I have for you guys is to try to include a plant-based protein at least during lunch or lunch and dinner. That is a very easy way to do it. Plus, it has so many protective benefits. It's a whole other talk, but it's really, really important. So what can you do? Right here, I recommend for my patients to seek out different beans. Right here, you're seeing it in a Tetra Pak. I have mine right here. These are great. They're like little cartons, and they have a variety of different beans. You can find them at Target. You can find them at Whole Foods. They don't cost more. What I love about these, besides the fact that you simply can open it with scissors at the office or anywhere, is that it doesn't have BPA or BPS in the lining like cans do. So it's just a benefit, and it's easy to get. And so why not? Why not bypass those two chemicals if you can? Another thing is sprouted lentils. I love them. I have them here too. Sprouted lentils, all lentils are great, but I love recommending sprouted one as well because they're fast. They're so fast. It takes 5 minutes to cook. You throw this in some water or broth, 5 minutes, it's ready. Now, usually foods that are quick to cook have had some of their nutritional value stripped away, but that's not the case with sprouted lentils or sprouted foods. They actually, on the contrary, enhance nutrient absorption. And then for anybody who's sensitive when it comes to introducing beans into their diet, it has less of those typical side effects associated with eating beans. So I highly recommend you check that out. It's so easy. You can keep organic shelled edamame in your freezer. Keep it simple, very simple. If it's not simple, it's not going to be built to last. You can have some ready-made foods as well. This is Peruvian lentils that are flavored, very convenient. You just open it up. And you can also take things to go. Take it in your purse. Like here, I've got these roasted garbanzo beans. They come in a package, ready to eat, super crunchy. Most people snack on them, which is great, but you can also just take it in your purse. And if you're trying to eat plant-based, you're trying to increase your fiber as well, then you can fetch a salad anywhere when you're traveling. But sometimes a plant-based protein is not available. Keep it in your purse. It's easy. You can also go with watermelon seeds, which are great. There are so many great options. Again, I can't stress enough how important it is to keep your strategy very simple. So again, we're looking at total day, 30 to 35 grams of fiber, essential to hit that target. And it looks complex in the background to get all this stuff, but it's very simple, very simple. And you want to diversify between insoluble fibers and soluble fibers. Now you're learning about those special prebiotic fibers and also the beta glucans. So have fun with that. And I want to show you an example of a breakfast. So this looks so simple. You know, you've got oatmeal, some fruit, some spice, but here's what I see as a dietitian behind the scenes. So I see the oats. So you've got some sprouted oatmeal here. Great, great source of those special immune supportive beta glucans. You've got an apple that has soluble and prebiotic fibers, a fiber booster. I chose to use basil seeds here. And so that could be a good starter for you. Just keep it simple and start integrating this and check off like, wow, I've got like 13 grams of fiber. That's starting my day on a high note. And I want to tell you that how you start your day really sets the tone for the rest of your day, which feels great. Prebiotic fiber powder, something you can start adding as you get used to it, you go to the next level. So you can add a prebiotic fiber powder if you want to. You can have fun and add a mushroom powder, which I'll be talking about later, and power spicing. I'll be talking about that as well. All of these things are upgrading your meals. And so very simple, lots in there. And here's another example, another favorite dish from my masterclass. It's a lentil stew. Disregard the bell pepper here. Just think simple, quick 10-minute prep lentil stew. And what I see here is I see 15 grams of fiber just in a cup. You're not going to get that from an animal-based protein. You're not going to get that unless you really think about it and put it there at least to help you get to that number. So 15 grams of fiber. And you got plenty of low starch vegetables here to help modulate your blood sugars. You've got mushrooms rich in those special beta glucans, onions and garlic, prebiotic fibers, and it's power spice. There's a lot going on here, yet it's simple. So that concludes fiber for you guys. And just to give you a little taste of it. So now I'm going to turn it to Lynn to take some questions.
Thank you. Thanks so much. That was great. Great information. I love how you break it down and really think about what would be in a bowl for breakfast, so that people can actually see that. All right. So a couple of questions. So someone has a question about, is it advisable to use something like Benefiber to help you reach the fiber goal?
So when you look at these products that you're using, that some of them have added sweeteners, and they come in different flavors. I think something like that I would use as like a little bit of a booster if you needed some support when it comes to bowel function. That could be a good thing to do. But I really think it's important to focus on your meals throughout the day and to distribute fiber. So I'm not against using those, but I think that's kind of like the cherry on top. You want to have a good strategy that includes these wholesome foods because you might be losing out on some things. Think about all those phytochemicals and all those, beneficial compounds that are packaged in the food.
Right. Great. Thank you. So one person has a question because, sometimes also with breast cancer treatment, people are losing weight. Yes. So this person's interested in gaining weight. Any tips or suggestions for things to eat? She gives examples of avocados, peanut or almond butter or things like that.
Yes. Yes. So you don't want to necessarily work on reducing your fiber intake because fiber is one piece of a puzzle or one country on a map. So what you want to think about is when you're trying to gain weight, and I experience this a lot when I work with patients who are undergoing treatment, who are experience unintentional weight loss, I recommend adding these, what I call high calorie boosters. So we have fiber boosters, we have high calorie boosters. So simple things that you can add, like I'll tell a patient to take pine nuts. Pine nuts are so soft and easy to digest as well. Tell them to put it in a bag and stomp on it with their shoe, crush it up, and then put it in a jar, and you keep it on the kitchen table, and add, if you're having, let's say, brown rice, add 2 or 3 tablespoons and integrate it. That's about a 250 calorie booster, and it's good for you. It supports your body during treatment. Those are smart calories, and that's a great way to go. And I have several examples just like that, but that would be something to focus on. You really, it's these, like, we sneak them in. These are high calorie boosters.
Great. Thank you. Sure. Since some people are joining us that are also have triple negative breast cancer, and I know you talked about the estrogen component with fiber, but I'm assuming that fiber still should be a priority in many other ways that you shared, even if there's a diagnosis of triple negative.
Absolutely. You're thinking about preventing colon cancer. You're thinking about, we talked about how fiber supports our immune system. It's not all about estrogen. So it's really all my patients who are triple negative. It is really important. It's so important to modulate your blood sugars. So many benefits. So I wouldn't skimp out on fiber. Again, estrogen is one part of it.
Great. Thank you. You touched on this, I think, with a little bit with the sprout and lentils, but do you have to increase fiber intake slowly due to increased gas?
Yes. Everyone's a little different. So when I work with patients, say, on the masterclass or whatnot, there's like a big announcement that goes out where we're using a very phased approach. And so I start people off with breakfast. Some people are like, wait, Rachel, no, I want everything at once. I'm like, nope, doesn't work that way. This is the method and this is how we do it, because we're all in it for the long run. So the strategy has to be very smart. It has to be very simple. It can be scientific, but it needs to be very simple. The secret sauce for us is to simplify everything. For us, it's complex. We're taking all this research and information. We have all these products, but our job is to put it right in front of you. So just like that with fiber, you want to have a phased approach. You're starting, let's say, with a fiber booster in the morning, and then we start adding some other things like a prebiotic fiber. And then we try some other things, and then we go to lunch and dinner. And some people have no problem. They just dive right into it, but everyone's different. And I think it's important to pace yourself. Yes, but sprouted lentils and things like that make it easier. So Great. Seek it out.
Yeah. Someone has a question just where they can purchase sprouted lentils.
Oh gosh, you can get them by us here in LA. There's Sprouts, there's Whole Foods, Amazon. Pretty easy to find these days. Yeah, they're a little pricier than regular lentils that you're buying, but again, and you don't have to eat sprouted. Just because I'm recommending the sprouted doesn't mean that's the only way to go. We're diversifying, but many of us need quick things. Like we end our work day and it's like we throw the towel and we just get takeout. Now, this is way, way cheaper than takeout. That's for sure, guaranteed. This is only like, it's less, it's like $3 for a bag. So it's definitely budget friendly. Better than takeout, but yeah, so.
Great. Now I know this isn't related to fiber, but this has been coming up a couple of, in regards to foods containing estrogen and soy. If you can just touch briefly on that, even though I know we're talking about fiber, that would be great.
Yeah, and I if we have time, I do have some slides on it. I just don't want to bounce all the way to the bottom right now, but nope. Soy is protective. If you look at the data especially post 2009, bottom line is that soy is very protective because we have, so we have our cells and there's an alpha and a beta receptor. Do you want me to get into it now or we can do it later?
I think just briefly, because I know we still have a lot to get through and I want to make sure we do that, but yeah. So, I would be remiss because a few people just asked about
okay. So bottom line is that eating soy, especially organic soy, is protective. It's beneficial. It is good for thrivership. Really, really great stuff. Top of the line cancer fighting protein, hands down.